Differentiation of functions from R to C is done on U and V separately. Integration is done similarly. This means in particular that we will be able to apply the fundamental theorem of calculus. We can use antiderivatives to do integration, as you will learn in this video. So suppose you have some function W from R to C. We split it up again like U of T plus R times V times of T. Then the integral of W is the integral of A of U plus I times the integral of V. So you integrate U and V separately. So that's an example. If you want to integrate e to the power I t from 0 to pi over 4, so what do you have to do? First, you have to find the real imaginary part, cosine t plus I times sine t, and you have to integrate those two separately. Integral of cosine t plus I times integral sine of t. Well, that's easy. Antiderivative of the cosine equals the sine. Antiderivative of the sine equals minus the cosine. Plug in the boundaries, you get sine pi over 4 minus sine 0. So sine pi over 4 equals 1 half square root of 2. And for the other one, you get the minus cosine pi over 4. So minus 1 half square root of 2 minus the cosine of 0. So that was 1. So that's how you can integrate such a function. So let's take a look at the fundamental theorem of calculus. What was it again? Well, it says that the integral from a to b fx dx equals f of b minus f of a, capital F's, where the derivative of capital F equals small f. So capital F is called an antiderivative of small f. Now, if we set capital W equals capital U plus I times capital V, now, and if we compute the derivative of capital U, we get in the separately, so derivative of capital U plus item derivative of capital V, derivative of capital U equals small u, derivative of capital V equals small v. So if we try to apply the fundamental theorem of calculus and want to integrate W, we have to split it into two parts. Suppose we have those separate antiderivatives, capital U and capital V, then we get as our antiderivative capital U plus I times capital V, which between the boundaries, which is the same as capital W minus capital at B minus capital W at A. So we can apply the fundamental theorem of calculus if we are able to find an antiderivative capital W of our function small w. And that's in the real case always a problem, and in the complex case as well, of course, because you have to find a function capital W such that if you differentiate, that you get your small w back again. Well, in the example, in the case of example 1, this is actually doable, because we know that if we differentiate e to the power I t over I, we can take the constant in front. And then you have the derivative of e to the power I t. We've seen that in the previous example. It yields I times e to the power I t. So we get an additional factor of I, which is equals e to the power I t. So you see that this function over here, e to the power I t over I, is the antiderivative of e to the power I t. So if you integrate e to the power I t, you get this antiderivative between the boundary points. So you get 1 over I equals minus I, of course. You get upper boundary minus lower boundary, e to the power pi I over 4 minus 1. And if you work this out, keep the minus I, e to the power pi I over 4 equals 1 half square root of 2 plus I times 1 half square root of 2. And keep the minus 1. And then split off a real and imaginary parts. You get minus I times I times square root of 2 over 2. So you get square root of 2 over 2. And as imaginary part, you get minus I times 1 half square root of 2, and a minus I times minus 1, so a plus 1. And you see that those results over here and over here are the same. So if you want to integrate a complex function, you can either split in u and v and integrate separately, or if you are able to find an antiderivative capital W of your small w, you can use this antiderivative instead.